Alright everybody, welcome back to another video. Spring is right around the corner, and you know what that means. We're getting ready to brew a lot more lighter and fruitier types of beer. Today, we're going to tackle a Kölsch. Fun fact, the very first video that I ever uploaded to YouTube on this channel was of a Kölsch brew day. The beer is pretty good, but the video was god-awful, and I have since deleted that video, so don't go looking for it. But we're going to go ahead and remake a Kölsch. Kölsch is actually one of my favorite styles of beer. It really has a very specific nuance to it that kind of sets it apart from things like light lagers or cream ales when you're trying to compare similar types of beer. And while those nuances may not be immediately apparent to everybody, they are indeed there. And I think they are indeed one of the characteristics that make this type of beer so enjoyable. As of like the mid-1980s, Kölsch is only used to describe a very specific type of beer that is brewed within 50 miles of Cologne. It's much like only being able to use champagne to refer to a specific type of sparkling wine from a specific part of the world. So while it may share a lot of characteristics with other pale German beers, it is indeed quite different because it is not a lager. This is in fact an ale, and more specifically, it's a hybrid beer. And what that really means is this is using a specific kind of yeast that has evolved over time to be able to ferment at or near lager temperatures, but still retain its biology as an ale yeast and produce the extra esters that we normally associate with ale yeasts and Saccharomyces cerevisiae. So what that means is you get a lot of the characteristics of both a lager fermentation and an ale fermentation. You get an increased amount of esters that are very specific to this kind of yeast, and you get the same clean and very, very enjoyable light, dry character of a lager yeast. And it really only shows up in two strains of yeast. Those are Kölsch strains and German ale strains. And funnily enough, these two yeasts actually evolved right down the road from each other. Well, just down the river, alt beer is the preferred style of beer. Both of these are very different beers, but they're brewed with similar hybrid yeasts. Kölsch is a light, pale, fluffy beer, and an alt beer is a darker, more full-bodied, and bitter beer. It is really interesting to kind of see how those hybrid beers evolved only in that very small region of Germany at the time. So ale has historically been brewed in Cologne for hundreds of years, and the entire time it was competing quite heavily, in fact, with lagers that were being brewed in other parts of Germany at the time. Lagers really were, at the time, the more popular type of beer, but the brewers of Cologne really fought to keep lagers out of their city. And as a result, ale really was the dominant beer in Cologne. It wasn't necessarily Kölsch yet at the time, though. The term Kölsch really didn't come around until the 20th century, in fact. The popularity of Kölsch really did continue to increase throughout the 20th century to the point where it was protected by the actual laws of the city. I know I'm kind of going on a tangent there, but the history of German beers really is pretty fascinating because it's a lot more history involved in these beers than most other beers out there. The beer we are looking for in this Kölsch is actually going to be very similar to a blonde ale, in fact, just brewed with German ingredients and in a more traditional German style. Blonde ales in America kind of tend to push the boundaries between what is a blonde ale and what's a American pale ale in terms of the hops, in terms of the fruity esters that are expressed. The Kölsch is going to have a lot more of those German characteristics, specifically from the yeast, and it's going to be a bit closer to a German lager in terms of flavor. However, it is going to have a little bit more of that fruitiness, and it's still going to be a little less clean than you would get with a pilsner. So this beer is going to be a little bit like a pilsner, a little bit like a blonde ale, a little bit like a cream ale, and a little bit like a Helles all at the same time. It's really a very unique thing, and it can't really be replicated or described in any other way, and that's why it's its own unique style. So this is going to be our recipe. We are going to be using 8.5 pounds of German pilsner, I'm using Weirmann, and 1 pound of wheat malt, also using Weirmann wheat malt. I think the wheat malt's going to add for a little bit of extra head retention and perhaps a little bit of a smoothness to the mouthfeel, we will see. And I'm also adding 3 ounces of acidulated malt because we're going to need some assistance in keeping the mash pH in check. And that's it. It's a very simple grist. You can add a little bit of Vienna malt if you want to. That'll add a little extra malt complexity and breadiness to the overall character. But I'm going to see what happens when we just kind of keep it to some of the more pale malts. So for hops, you can really use any German noble. You can use Hallertauer, Tettnang, Herzbrücker, Spalt, all are good options. I'm using Hallertauer Mittelfruhr, so I'm using 1.75 ounces at 60 minutes and half an ounce at 15 minutes. And all of mine is 3.7% alpha acid. Yeast on a Kölsch is pretty much non-negotiable. If you really want it to be as close to a German Kölsch as possible, you're going to want to use the dedicated Kölsch yeast. In my case, I use Y-Yeast, and that is Y-Yeast 2565 Kölsch. You can get away with other types of ale yeasts. However, you're not really going to get the same ester profile that you would get out of an actual Kölsch yeast. So for the water on this one, we're going to want to keep it pretty light, pretty minimal in minerals. So I'm starting from 8 gallons of distilled water, and that means that you can copy this water profile exactly if you also use distilled water or RO water. So we're aiming for pretty much as minimal mineral concentration as possible to really preserve the delicate aspects of this this beer's flavor. But we are adding a little bit of extra calcium and a little bit of extra chloride to this whole thing just to keep the proper ratios between ions and to make sure that the fermentation and mash efficiency is kept in check where we want it to be. So this is my water profile. I have 27 parts per million of calcium, 3 parts per million of magnesium, 13 parts per million of sodium, 67 parts per million of chloride, 12 parts per million of sulfate, and 0 parts per million of bicarbonate. And in order to get that profile, I am adding 2 8-gallons of distilled water, 1 gram of Epsom, 1 gram of sodium chloride, and 3 grams of calcium chloride. That is it. So for our mash, I'm gonna shake it up for the first time in a while. I haven't done a step mash in a long time. So we're gonna try and use a step mash here to really attenuate this beer as much as possible. And I think that is really the traditional way this is done. So we're doing a 2-step mash. The first step is gonna be 145 degrees Fahrenheit for 45 minutes, which will be the beta amylase rest, and 162 Fahrenheit for 30 minutes, which is the alpha amylase rest. This should allow us to take full advantage of the malts that we have here. This way we can get a very low finish in gravity and high attenuation without leaving the beer overly watery. And that's kind of a big advantage of using a step mash profile like this. But anyway, I got my claw hammer system for today. Everything is all heated up and ready to go. So let's get over there and get to it. Once the strike water in my clawhammer supply 120 volt system reached the required temperature, I mashed in with the grain bill, being sure as usual to break up any clumps in the mash. Next, I restarted the recirculation. 10 minutes in, I recorded a mash pH of 5.14 and actually remembered to document it this time. That pH is a bit low, but it's nothing to worry about too much. If you are brewing this recipe exactly the same as me though, I would just recommend maybe nixing about 1/2 ounce to 1 ounce of the acid malt to bring the pH up to a slightly higher number. After this, I let the mash sit for 45 minutes at 145 degrees. After 45 minutes, I increased the temperature on the controller to 162 degrees, and I let the mash sit at that temperature for 30 minutes. Once 30 minutes had elapsed, I set the temperature on the controller to 168 degrees for the mash out. This step denatures all enzymes in the mash and it helps the wort drain through the grain bed a bit easier. After reaching the mash out temperature, I let it stay there for about 15 minutes, and then I pulled out the grain basket and let that drain for another 15 minutes. However, as soon as I did that, I fired up the controller to 100% power to get a jump start on the boil. I pulled a sample of wort for the pre-boil gravity reading, and I recorded a measurement of 11.5 bricks, or 1045. This number is actually a full 4 points higher than Beersmith had predicted, even when I selected a step mash profile for the mash profile in the recipe design. This goes to show just how much the step mash actually increased my mash efficiency. Once I reached the boil, I added my first hop addition, 1¾ ounces of Hallertauer Mittelfruhr. Then I let the boil continue for another 45 minutes before coming back to add my 15-minute addition, another 1/2 ounce of Hallertauer Mittelfruhr. I also added a Whirlflock tablet at this time and some yeast nutrient. At that point, I also started recirculating boiling wort through my chiller in order to sanitize it. As I say every single video, this is the easiest way to ensure sanitation of your chilling equipment. After 15 more minutes had elapsed, I ended the boil, I took the whole setup inside, and I hooked up my chiller to the sink, and I began chilling. I let the wort chill down to the groundwater temperature of 65 degrees, and then I pitched the entire yeast starter.
At this time, I aerated the wort with pure oxygen utilizing the carb stone with a dose of about 1 minute at full blast. Alternatively, you can splash the wort aggressively into a sanitized fermenter to generate slightly lower but similar levels of dissolved oxygen. I took a sample and recorded a surprising original gravity of 11.5 bricks, which is 1045. Again, it's exactly the same as my pre-boil gravity for some odd reason. I think my wort may have actually stratified when I took my original gravity sample, leading to an inaccurate measurement.
Okay, so let's talk about fermentation now. Like I said in the introduction, this is a hybrid beer, which means even though that it's an ale yeast, it is going to ferment at a cold temperature. And the optimum temperature for this beer is actually 60 degrees Fahrenheit. This yeast will actually fully attenuate a beer at 60 degrees Fahrenheit. It may not be a particularly fast fermentation, but I've used this yeast before and it does a fantastic job even at a cooler temperature like that. As with most yeasts, if you increase the temperature beyond the recommended range, you're gonna end up probably pushing a lot more fruity-like esters out of it. Just be advised though, if you push that fermentation range a little too much, you can risk having fermentation-related off flavors and flaws in the beer, such as fusel alcohols or hot-tasting beer. You don't really want that sort of thing, especially in a delicate style like a Kölsch. I am going to be holding this at 60 degrees. We're not actually going to do a ramp-up on this. I don't think we're going to need it. We're going to hold it at 60 degrees for about 2 weeks. Next comes the other piece of the hybrid fermentation, and that is a deliberate lagering phase. If you're rushing this beer, you probably could do it with gelatin finings or any other sort of finings. Because it's such a low flocculating strain, it's gonna take a lot longer for that yeast to drop out of solution as compared to other types of beers. So just be patient with it if you're doing a classic lagering, but you can also hit it with some finings and that should help out as well. You wanna lager this basically until the beer is absolutely crystal clear, and I mean bright. Kölsch is a traditionally clear beer. A lot of times you will see cloudy examples because not just is it a clear beer, but it's also a quick spoiling beer. So you really have to strike a balance between, do you want to serve this beer fresh when it tastes its best, or do you want to serve this beer bright when it looks its best? All in all, fermentation should take probably about 1 to 2 weeks for primary, and then 2 to 3 weeks for the actual lagering phase, and then after that you should be able to package. I've made this beer in a bucket fermenter before, so don't worry if you don't have the fancy equipment that I do. You should still be fine, just keep it in a cool location where you can maintain that 60 degree temperature. If you do happen to have a conical, it's probably going to speed up your fermentation a bit, as it will encourage the yeast to drop out a bit faster. And lastly, but certainly not least, don't ferment this under pressure. It's going to suppress the esters and you're going to end up with a bland tasting pale ale. I really do think the key piece of this beer's flavor is the yeast expression, so try not to suppress that or mute that in any way by providing any sort of external pressure during fermentation.
So final gravity came in on the Kölsch pretty quick after about 10 days. It's 1006, I think maybe 1007. I'm gonna say probably 1006. It's pretty dry, I think even for Kölsch, but that might help kinda let some more of these delicate flavors shine. We shall see. I'm going to package it and start the lager.
All right, so now we are at 18 days. This actually ended up finishing up a little bit faster than I expected it to. When fermentation had completed, I actually transferred over to a keg using a closed transfer, and then I let it get cold in that keg. The next morning, I added some gelatin to help speed up the clarification process, and it worked like a charm. This beer was actually clear within 3 days of getting it in the keg, which was pretty awesome. It's now about 4 days since it actually dropped really bright, and it's conditioned to a point now where it's actually pretty tasty, so we're gonna go ahead and taste it. And here today I have a very specific kind of glassware, which is called a Stange, I believe. Here on this channel I've pissed off a lot of Germans by pronouncing things wrong, so let me know. But anyway, this is a traditional kind of glassware that's used to drink both Kölsch and alt beer. And it's basically a 200 milliliter tall, like, test tube type glass anyway, but it actually looks pretty cool when it's full. So I'm gonna go ahead and pour it for you guys.
All right, so the beer is called Golden Days and it comes in at 5.1% ABV and 25 IBUs. Before we get any further into this video, I just want to give a shout out to Elementary Brewing Company. Elementary Brewing Company is another channel on YouTube about home brewing, and he does a lot more grand glass videos as well. And his are a little bit shorter and probably more digestible than mine, but hands down, he makes fantastic content. And his Kölsch brew from a couple of weeks, maybe a couple of months ago, just kind of gave me the idea
to do one of my own. And I just want to thank him for that. Go check his channel out. It is well worth your time. I think you're going to enjoy it. All right, so for appearance of the beer, it's actually really nice and super pale. This thing is coming in at a nice light golden straw color that is absolutely beautiful. It is 100% crystal clear, completely bright. Really nice, beautiful white head on it, stark white. It's a really, really appetizing beer to look at, seeing all those bubbles rising. All right, so next let's go in for aroma. It's got a nice light floral aroma. And picking up the Pilsner malt, yeah, you get that kind of like crackery Pilsner character mixed with some nice floral and spicy hop aroma from the Hallertau. That's pretty pleasant, not gonna lie. All right, so now let's go ahead and go in for mouthfeel. Oh yeah, mouthfeel is nice and light. Very, very light, bordering on crispy. It's almost that clean. It is almost lager clean. Nice and spritzy with the carbonation level, but it's not overcarbed at all. Very clean, very light bodied, very drinkable, very dry finishing, but not like, I keep saying this when I say very dry finishing, it's not saison dry because that's in a class of its own. However, I will say that the wheat that I added actually is coming through a little bit and it's kind of rounding out some of the hard edges. So you kind of get this very, very smooth character to it as well. So I'm a fan of that. Now, before I go in for flavor, I'm actually gonna go ahead and refill this because I've already gone through a good portion of it. Now, I'm trying to stay in the shade today because a very pale, very light beer like this is highly susceptible to becoming light struck. And what that means is if I stick it out here in the sunlight for like 30 seconds, honestly, the UV rays from the sun, direct exposure to it, can actually change the flavor for the worse. You'll get a very fast skunking flavor that way, and that's not something we really want. And even in the shade, that's somewhat possible. I don't think it's as risky as if I was in direct sunlight, but having a fresh pour allows me to sort of mitigate that when I go into the flavor piece, which is what we're about to go into right now. So like I said at the beginning of the video, the target for this beer was kind of something between a Pilsner and a blonde ale. And I think we nailed it, to be honest. This is really, really good. It is super crushable and just has that nice, delicate flavor without all of the aggressive hoppiness of the Pilsner and without all of the fruitiness and kind of American character of a blonde ale. So the flavor I'm getting mostly like a white bread, as well as some like crackery notes, and then also a little bit of a kind of a toast character. There's a little bit of a honey note in here as well, kind of on the finish. On top of that, there's definitely also some fruitiness in here. I think some of it is from the yeast, and a lot of it I think is from the hops as well. It's a little bit of like a floral fruity character. The Hallertau are really manifesting themselves in a very floral way, which I really like. It's kind of got this like rose petal lavender kind of character to it, which only really comes through in these delicate beers like this. It's very, very similar to a Pilsner, but it's not as crisp, I think, as a Pilsner would otherwise be. It's a little fruitier. But if I'm being completely honest, I think I may have actually fermented this too clean and ended up with more of a lager-esque beer. So when this was younger and not as clear as it is now, it actually had a lot more of a banana character to it from the yeast, but that is gone now. But there is a little bit of a yeast note in there. It's coming through kind of like bubblegummy. Very, very subtle. This is actually a very, very clean beer. So when I'm looking for yeast character, it's kind of difficult to find, which, yeah, it's not really the right thing to say about a Kölsch. If I'm being completely honest, this beer is actually fantastic. I really love the way it came out, regardless of what I'm aiming for. But I think there are still some potential improvements that I could go with here. And first of all, I think I would probably ferment this a little bit higher just to get a little bit more yeast expression. So maybe you want to go for something like a 65 degree fermentation, because it's really very clean as it is right now, and it's trending more towards that Pilsner type of character than that blonde ale type of character, just because of how clean it is. There is still some expression of the yeast. You get a little bit of bubble gum, you get a little bit of like a berry character as well, which is nice. And it's not really there to a degree that really makes it like super reliably easily distinguished from a Pilsner. But that's just my palate. A lot of people do experience these things differently, and your palate may be different than mine. I think the other thing I would do to make this a little bit more different than its lager cousin would be to add just a dash of Vienna malt, you know, just maybe like half a pound of Vienna, maybe up to 1 pound, just to add a little additional malt complexity. As it is right now, this beer is awesome though. This is without a doubt one of those beers that you can give to somebody who doesn't drink craft beer on the regular and they will love it. And I did that exactly. I gave the cloudy young version of this to basically somebody who doesn't really drink that much craft beer, and they crushed it, they loved it. They wanted more, and I have to give them more now. So, problem is, I really love this beer myself, and I kind of want to keep it. Brew it this way if you want to. Brew it with the different suggestions that I added if you want to. I think it'd be happy and regardless. But I absolutely love this thing, and it makes a great spring beer. I really do think the wheat malt addition came through nicely on this. I think I would keep that. There are different Kölsch yeasts out there, but I have used 2565 before, and I did like the way it came out last time. It did express itself a lot more last time I brewed a Kölsch, though, and I did have warmer temperatures during that fermentation. So I think if I'm really gonna kind of be anal about something, I would say definitely raise the temperature. 65 to 67 probably will get you a lot more of the Kölsch character. Because as it is right now, it is basically just a copycat Pilsner. That being said, it's really good copycat Pilsner. The other thing that is really worth talking about here is the low mineral content in this water profile. Oh my gosh. This is the first time I brewed a pale, light German type beer with distilled water and building off of like a nearly 0 parts per million kind of base. And holy cow, does that make a difference? This is probably one of the cleanest, lightest, most delicate tasting beers that I have made out of custom water profiles ever. And because of that, the noble hop character is really coming through in such a pleasant way. And honestly, this makes an absolutely massive difference. And if you are considering brewing a light, pale beer like this, like lager or ale, I do implore you to start with distilled water because of my results on this. You can get good results as well using regular water, even if it's a relatively high mineral content, by adjusting it properly or diluting it. And I've done that before and I've had good results. I made a German Pils that way that was pretty good, but it's just not as good as this. This is really good. I like it a lot, and I'm rambling. So anyway, I'm gonna wrap up here. So before you go, if you liked the video and if you learned something and if you enjoyed it, please hit that like button. Please subscribe if you want more content like this. I am throwing out videos as best I can on a weekly basis. I will try to upload Friday mornings. And if you don't want to wait around that long to see what's going on in my brewing life, go ahead and follow me on Instagram. It's at the Apartment Brewer, or you can check out my Patreon, which is up here in the corner. There's a lot of additional video content over there as well. Comment down below, let me know what you think about the beer, the brew session, cultures in general, the equipment I'm using, the processes I'm doing. Let me know what you think. I do read every single comment, and I do my best to respond to as many of them as I can. The recipe for this beer, as always, is in the description box down below, and that is for a Clawhammer Supply 120 volt system. If you have an Anvil Foundry, Grainfather, Robo Brew, Brew's Edge Mash and Boil, I think I got most of the popular ones. If you got one of those all-in-one 120 volt systems, you're going to have a very similar experience brewing this recipe. So tweak it a little bit as you may need to, but otherwise the recipe as a whole should pretty much work for you. Also in the description box, you're gonna find a link to the Clawhammer Supply system. So if you're interested in purchasing it, please go through that link. It does help me out quite a bit. I earn a small commission off of that. And also in the description box is a list of other brewing equipment that I use. If you happen to be in the market for it and you wanna help support the channel, that is a great way to do so. Thanks for watching, guys, and I will catch you guys in the next one. So until then, cheers.
NBC.